everyone. Thanks for joining us today for our LinkedIn Live event about enabling a digital mindset. I'm Zari Venhaus, Vice President of Corporate Marketing Communications at Eaton. Before we jump in, while we're really excited to have you participate in this live today, we do seem to have some party crashers. So we've caught some spammers that are running a phishing scheme on this page. So we've got moderators in the background who are removing those posts, but just want to remind you to not click on the links in those posts. We're going to be reporting them to LinkedIn, and we don't want it to influence your experience with us today. So let's get to the good stuff. Talk about enabling a digital mindset. Eaton, as an intelligent power management company, is well positioned to play a leading role in the digital transformation happening in our world today. And we've learned a few things along this journey that we thought we could share with you today. Ensuring that employees develop digital skills and mindsets to keep up with and even get ahead in our modern world is becoming increasingly important for businesses all around the world. Embracing digital and innovation is not an option anymore. And accelerating talent for today's world is critical to remaining competitive. But how can employees develop these skills? And how can their companies help? Some of you might also even be wondering, what even is digital mindset? To answer these questions and more, I have two amazing leaders from Eaton who are helping to guide us in our digital transformation, Cindy Fisher and Debbie Rossignol. Ladies, would you each take a couple of minutes to introduce yourselves, please? Cindy, we'll start with you.
Sure thing. Hi, good morning, Zari. Good morning, everybody. Really excited to be here today. My name is Cindy Fisher. I'm the Vice President of Learning and Culture for Eaton, and I've been working very closely with our Chief Digital Officer, our Digital Office, all of our leadership team to help to embed digital into our culture, and super excited here to be here today talking about digital mindset, such an important thing. Thanks, Zari.
Debbie?
Hi, I'm Debbie Rossignol. I lead HR for the digital organization. It's a relatively new organization at Eaton. I partner very closely with Cindy and the others she mentioned on our digital transformation strategy. I also lead the work on our digital talent strategy. How do we make sure we have the talent that we need to achieve our digital strategy?
Great. Thank you both. I also want to remind everyone who's with us today that we're going to be answering your questions today. So please submit them via the comment section, and we're going to do our best to respond to as many as we can. So let's jump right in. Before today's event, we polled our attendees to find out where you guys feel you're at when it comes to enabling a digital mindset. Are you a beginner, intermediate, advanced, or are you asking yourself the question, what is a digital mindset? And what we found is a really, I think, maybe a little bit surprising results, but this group is saying that overwhelmingly 39% of you feel like you're intermediate, like you've got a good foundation to work with, and 24% saying they felt like they were advanced in this space. So what's really important to know is when we're looking at these results is that everyone's at a different place in their journey and is going to have a different comfort level with these concepts. So hopefully as you leave today, you're going to have a better understanding about what digital mindset means and what steps you can take to grow and develop your skills. So let's jump into a question. Debbie, before we talk specifically about digital mindset, can you talk a little bit about Eaton's digital strategy?
Absolutely, because digital mindset has to really enable our strategy. So we have two main goals as it relates to digital: to deliver $500 million in incremental revenue and to deliver 5 to 10% functional productivity. So in order to support those two goals, we have created a strategy that has four pillars. So you can see of the four pillars that are on the screen now. So it's about new business models, the digital customer experience, factory of the future, or otherwise known as Industry 4.0, and functional productivity. And as we've really been on this journey, we've asked every employee, you know, to kind of identify where are you on in each of those pillars? How can you really help impact each of those pillars? And no matter where you are, you can tie your work to one of those pillars at least. So if you think about our salespeople, they may be more closely tied to the first two pillars around revenue generation or customer experience. An operations leader, a continuous improvement person, they'd be more closely tied to factory of the future. And then every single person in all the functions, they really need to link their work to how can we drive functional productivity based on the goals within our function.
Thank you, Debbie. So let's talk and transition to what does it mean to have a digital mindset? So Cindy, can you tell us what this means for Eaton?
Sure thing. And I, you know, it's funny, you hear about digital mindset so much. And I think a lot of people, it's feeling like a buzzword, right? And so lots of companies are defining this differently. So I'm happy to share a little bit about how Eaton is approaching it. You know, any consulting firm that you talk to might also have some different perspectives on how they think about it. You know, our chief digital officer talks quite a bit about the fact that, you know, it's as much about the people as it is about the technology when you think about digital transformation. And I think that has definitely resonated with us. You know, it's not just the tech, it's our mindset and our behaviors, our attitudes, how we go about our work. And, you know, I think, you know, you hear a lot of common things when you talk to other companies, when you talk to consulting firms, when you research or Google online, you know, that mindset piece is a lot about, you know, customer facing, being externally focused, you know, having a growth mindset, being able to not just leverage data, but create insight from data, being iterative, having empowerment, being comfortable with risk, you know, that whole kind of failing fast and pivoting. So that's a bit around what you hear. And, you know, we've kind of taken all of that information here at Eaton and really started, you know, based upon what Debbie said earlier, kind of ground ourselves in what is our strategy? What are we trying to do? And we've tried to really simplify digital mindset for us is simply it's about leveraging technology, data, and insights to create, you know, that value for whether it's our customer or the value internally, you know, at Industry 4.0 or, you know, functional productivity, how we're operating, and then also ensuring that we're operating in an agile way. And we've, you know, really applied that same focus to how we serve our customers, find value for them, as well as how we internally are working. And I'm super proud of us as a company. Not every company goes so far as to say, this is going to be, you know, part of our leadership model or a part of how we operate. And our senior leadership committee really felt strongly that that was important. This is a big enough strategic transformation for our company that we've got to embed it into who we are and how we operate. And so we have made the decision to bake digital mindset into our Eaton leadership model. And as I mentioned, I mean, we had a lot of components, and here's the model popping up for me here. We had a lot of components in our model that spoke to agility previously or spoke to being externally facing, customer focused. And so, you know, we were thoughtful about what do we need to add to our model to ensure that we're inclusive of the pieces that might not be covered already in other areas of our model. And so you can see some of our choices and decisions around, you know, continuously building digital skills to simplify work processes, you know, that ability to leverage both digital technology and processes like design thinking and others to, you know, creatively problem solve, whether it's internal or external, leveraging data, not just, you know, the ability to analyze it, but the ability to make better decisions, create insight. The leveraging of digital tools, you know, being much more hyper collaborative, not just internally, but also externally. And then really focusing in on, you know, the digitalization of data. We also really, as we reflected on where are we strong and where do we need to kind of double down on, we really felt that, you know, the need to empower our teams in order to be innovative, to be creative, to experiment was also sort of mission critical. And so we've added that to our leadership model, and it's something that we're continuing to build within our leaders as we move forward as well. And I, you know, it kind of doesn't matter where you are today. I mean, I think whether you work for Eaton or you work for another company or you're in a totally different industry, being digital and having a digital mindset is kind of part of what it means to, you know, to continue to succeed. And so I think it's kind of important regardless of what lens you're coming at it from. Hopefully that helps.
That was great. Thanks, Cindy. So why don't we go to our next question? You know, when we talk about the leadership model, right? And Cindy, you talked about going back to our strategy. And we did have someone who wanted to bring that pillar slide back up again. I do think it's really good to, when we think about leadership and mindset, that it comes back to strategy. So if we think about, you know, our strategic approach to digital transformation and these key areas, you know, Debbie, could maybe you just comment, and it's maybe reiterating a little bit of what you said earlier, but how important it is for all employees to feel connected to these pillars?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And maybe I'll just talk a little bit about how we've done that. So in the beginning of this year, we launched an executive series that was built around what is digital mindset. And then it provided more information around these digital pillars. So the first thing that we did is make sure our most senior leaders in the company knew what it is we were talking about as it related to our strategy and those pillars. So that as they're leading, they're setting digital goals for their organizations, as they're, you know, setting their priorities, they're determining how to hold people accountable, that all links to that strategy. And then we've also and I'm talking about a lot of things that Cindy's org does, by the way, so I should be giving her tons of credit. But like when we talk about then how do we embed that into our leadership development curriculum too, or all employee development curriculum, so that all employees know what that means, and they know how they can apply it in their job in all, you know, in related to that strategy and achieving our growth.
And I think, you know, when we start to talk about candidates for roles, right, for what we're looking at, not just for people coming into Eaton, but what we're looking for employees to develop at Eaton, but I think a lot of other companies are thinking along the same lines. So Debbie, when you're interacting with prospective candidates, what qualities or skills are you really looking for someone to be able to illustrate?
Sure, sure.
For
any specific role, you always look for functional capabilities. And so there are definitely certain functional capabilities that we're trying to build more of within our organization. So if you're in a sales role, you know, how do you sell digital products differently? If you're in a product management role, how does that process differ? And do you have that experience and knowledge related to that function? So we have a functional capability strategy where we are upskilling our workforce based on the needs of the organization and continuing to evolve that. But we also, you know, have if we look at those skills that Cindy described earlier, you know, how are people agile? Can they take risks? Are they driving innovation? Are they using data to drive better decisions? We've created interview questions to really help assess those skills as we're looking at candidates. And that would be for any role within Eaton, whether it's a role within the digital office or anywhere else.
And what kinds of roles, I'm just going to stay with you, Debbie, but what kinds of roles are new roles maybe are we looking at in the organization?
Yeah. And I'll focus on the revenue generating pillar just to kind of give some examples there to go deeper there. If the types of roles we're adding in sales are roles like solution architects or software business development managers. In our product management group, we are adding more offer managers and product owners. In our engineering group, it's, you know, it could be engineers for cloud, for embedded, cyber, data scientists, technical support. Those are just a handful of the types of roles that we're hiring this year and next year. And of course, we'd love you, anyone who's interested, to check that out on our site and apply. Just a little plug.
I think that leads nicely into a question we have from our audience. So when we talk about kind of new roles, new skills, new capabilities, there's a lot of coordination that needs to happen between functions. And Mary has asked how to best coordinate IT with other business areas, as IT tends to be a pretty big part of digitalization efforts. Cindy, could you maybe start on that one?
Yeah, sure. And I'll be enough to be dangerous here, but you know, I think, you know, based upon what I've observed and how we're approaching this here at Eaton, you know, we have gone back to the strategy over and over again. It's sort of what are we trying to do and how are we trying to approach that, and those pillars sort of being our grounding point of the how. And then we have, you know, a chief technology officer, we have a chief information officer, we have our chief digital officer. And I have to kind of give props to all three of them within our organization who have, you know, Raja Macha is our chief technology officer, Katrina Redman, our information officer, and then Aravind Yarlagada. All three of them have really been purposeful around how they in particular work together on this strategy. And so all of the businesses and functions, every single one of us is going to be part of this transformation, whether you're a fast roller or you're going to come slightly later. But they have been very collaborative in how they've sort of approached our digital strategy. And so those three in particular, I think that connection across becomes important. And then the role of, that IT needs to play comes down to what is the vision for the strategy and where are you going? And so, you know, Katrina, I know, was just recently on some town halls. She even attended an HR town hall that we had. and kind of talking about, you know, where does IT need to support, you know, us even 10 years down the road? And how do we, you know, start working our way into that? And so there's, you know, I think constantly this a little bit of, you know, kind of challenge that IT as an organization. So those of you in an IT function, it's challenging. You have to keep the infrastructure in place that's already operating today. It can't, you know, the infrastructure you're operating in can't fall apart. And then how do you continue to ensure that we can enable the infrastructure that we don't even know what that might exist from 10 years from now? And so in our organization, those three leaders are really collaborating together to ensure that they're kind of tightly linked as they continue to determine, you know, where IT fills in, what capabilities do we need, where are we going to focus, how do we ensure we're able to innovate? So it's an exciting time, but it's also, you know, a challenging time for all those reasons.
Great, thank
Maybe
you.
Maybe if I just add something like structurally, yeah. You know, so when you think about those three pillars, you know, one of our leaders, Ray Huber, he owns the customer experience pillar and he's in the IT org and he functionally reports to Arvind. So we ensure that there's really close collaboration. When you think about the factory of the future pillar, it's, you know, owned by somebody in operations, but then also somebody in IT has a key leadership role, you know, closely partnering with the digital office. And then if you think of the functional productivity, there's lots of ownership and direction on automation and things like that that come from the IT department. So it's IT is so deeply embedded in our strategy.
Absolutely. And reminder to everyone, we're taking your questions. So please submit them in the chat. I do want to maybe continue the thread on technology, right? So we talked about the coordination between the different kind of, you know, the digital information and technology officers. But what about people, and this is a question from our audience, what about people who feel like technology doesn't come easily for them? What does that mean for their ability to grow in their careers? Maybe Debbie, you could start with an answer for that one, and then Cindy, maybe sure. Add on.
Sure. I mean, I think everybody has different comfort levels with new things. Technology can be one of those new things. Public speaking could be another one. But I would just, you know, make sure that you understand for your role, for your function or business and where you sit in the organization, understanding what technology, what data, you know, what qualities do you really need to have and develop with yourself in order to really meet the objectives and how you tie into the strategy. So, you know, you may, you know, read about certain things, certain technologies that may not have anything to do with your job. And so you don't necessarily need to know that much about them. But what do you really need to know and understand and develop to really drive effectiveness in your role?
I couldn't agree more. And I think, you know, one of the things that just it resonates for me when I started working with the digital office leaders and our CDO around this topic, we had actually had a conversation around this, and we were having the discussion around just experimentation. And a lot of people, you know, are afraid of a new app or a new technology. And it's just, you know, part of it is the experimentation mm-hmm. and learning what works and learning what doesn't. And that was kind of a mindset shift for me, even as I think about some of the tech coming our way of, you know, whether it's Power BI or something else where, you know, even in my role, it's sometimes easy to kind of remove myself and be like, okay, you know, hey, can someone else take that and then show me the output? But it's really kind of just leaning into that experimentation. You know, it reminds me of when texting came out. I remember I was in, I was actually doing an assignment in Europe at the time. And, you know, in the US, texting was not a thing yet. You didn't communicate like that. And like the first night I was there, someone was like, well, I'll text you where to go for dinner. And I remember looking at my little flip phone and being like, well, how does that work? And think about how fast like that took off like rapid fire, right? It's like, I'm like, you know, typing AAA, BBB to try to make words at the time out of my flip phone. And we all kind of, you know, quickly learn how to do that through experimentation. So it just reminds me of, you know, as I'm learning some of these new technologies, thinking about some of that transition and how easy that was because I wasn't afraid to, you know, try out and play with things. And, you know, we have all learned our iPhones in and out if you have one or our, other smartphones. So just using that same approach when thinking about technologies at work, I think is really helpful.
And the other side of that coin too, is there's a lot of training out there and available. So even if your organization maybe doesn't offer it yet, I mean, on the interwebs, right out on the internet, there's a lot of great organizations that really do focus on helping to upskill and train people on new tools and technologies and kind of approaches to that. That I know we're bringing some of that into our organization. Maybe Cindy, you could touch on that a little bit too.
Or can I just add a little example of that one? So when I was trying to get better at OneNote a couple of years ago, I just went to YouTube and watched a couple of videos for a couple of hours. And now I'm, you know, now I'm super proficient at OneNote, and it really is a helpful organizational tool. And it was all free, just stuff I found on YouTube.
Yeah, I think there's so many options like that that are out there that it's kind of amazing. Any technology, you can basically Google it today and you'll find a video of somebody using it and leveraging it. You know, if you have the luxury of being part of a large company like we are, there are resources in place. So those of you that are listening from Eaton today, go into Eaton University, just, you know, type an actual Eaton University search just like Google, and you can find lots of curriculum that are out there today and you know, around some of the topic areas that we'll talk about today. You know, at Eaton, we are really thinking about digital mindset around, you know, not only the mindset you have to have and how we continue to operate more in an agile way, but then also we are thinking about also some of the major sub skills. And I'm sure we'll talk more about that today, but, you know, we've mentioned already data analytics. We've talked a little bit about design thinking, risk taking. So we are working on, you know, sort of a tiered approach for that at Eaton. And I think it kind of goes back to what Debbie said earlier. Depending on the role that you have, depending on the business that you're in and the strategy, really kind of peeling that onion back to say, okay, well, where do I need to be most proficient? Or is it a job that I want in the future? Where is that going to be most helpful to me? What skill do I need the most? Is there a certain technology that's going to enable me faster? Is there a mindset I need to have? Do I need to get really good at design thinking? Whatever that is for you, thinking about, well, how skilled do I need to be? And that's a little bit of how we're kind of approaching it here at Eaton, is we're thinking about it in a tiered way. We're kind of saying, you know, at a first tier level, it's like, I got to have basic understanding. I need to know what machine learning is when someone says it out loud to me, and how algorithms work, and what I'm looking at. And then there might be a much more advanced, you know, what a data scientist needs, which, you know, that, to Debbie's point, curriculum, you're not going to like Google that online and find that. And so really understanding, you know, where do I link back into my business? What's my work? And also, what do I aspire to do, and trying to use that to kind of prioritize where you focus. But most companies today have some type of offering, you know, that you can, you know, play with, and we're developing ours and making ours more robust at this moment. But there's lots out there today that can help you in this moment as well.
And maybe if I can just add a little bit to that. So that's great things to do at the individual level, but then we also ask teams to do that. So teams to think about, okay, when it comes to being more agile, what do we need to do as a team to work in an agile way? What do we need to do differently? And what are we going to agree to as a team? So it applies as a team, it applies as an individual, and both lenses are very important.
And it's not like you have to be advanced in everything. I think that point, Cindy, that you made is so important. So if there's some things that maybe you're not going to be the specialist in, that's okay. You might just need that basic understanding. And then to Debbie's point, like, use your team, right? Mm-hmm. There are other people in your organization who have that skill set. And, you know, if you can leverage their knowledge and their support and their help to help you learn more, that can be really beneficial also. So one of the other things we polled our audience on before the event today was about digital skills and where people feel like they have opportunities to improve. So around using data to make decisions, diverse hyper-collaboration, taking calculated risks, or agile continuous improvement. And what we found from you guys is that most of you said you feel like you could develop further in using data to make decisions. So 33% of you said that's the area where you could really grow. It was kind of split between that and agile continuous improvement. So if these are some areas where we think we as employees need to further develop, Cindy, can you give some advice to our audience about people who are looking to develop their digital mindset and things that they should be thinking about or doing?
Absolutely. And I think, by the way, if it feels daunting to you, I think that's very normal. So it can really feel super daunting when you think about how do I develop all these skills and what's super important. So I'll kind of share the advice that we're short of sharing internally with our teams. I think it does go back to that strategy. What are you focused on? What's important? We had an external speaker with our executives that Debbie mentioned earlier. We did this executive series in the beginning of the year. And one of the external speakers we brought in was a gentleman by the name of Tom Davenport. And he uses this term, don't commit random acts of digital. And I loved it. And it made everybody laugh. But I think you got to think about also with your capability and where you're focusing. And it's just a good reminder to kind of do that prioritization that Debbie and I just kind of talked about. And then we've been really kind of giving our folks two bits of advice. One, learn the digital strategy. So that would be my first bit of advice for you. Regardless of where you're working, what you're doing, what is the digital strategy? Maybe it's not fully articulated yet, and that's okay. But there's probably some direction or some place that the business is heading, or even as you look outside, that the industry is heading. And you can kind of just start to ground yourself in what does that look like? What does that look like for me and my work and my function? And that's one piece of advice that we're giving to our teams today. And we're providing some content and support around Eden's digital strategy to ground themselves in that. And then the second is, there is a continuum, right? And so there's a continuum of having digital mindset versus not. And we do have some tools internally that we've shared with our teams, and we're actually resharing as we go into the end of the year here, as people are continuing to develop, to say, okay, where am I on that continuum? And based upon where I'm at, again, that prioritization, I don't have to be amazing at everything, but especially if I've got a glaring opportunity. And by the way, you guys are not alone. I wrote down 33% of you said data analytics. We see that internally as well. I think a lot of us that grew up, especially if you grew up in a big company, you got really good at creating spreadsheets and creating numbers, but linking multiple pieces of data, you know, through a data lake or something along those lines, and leveraging a Power BI and visualizing data might be skills that just the muscle is not there yet. And so, you know, maybe you're in a role where that muscle is mission critical, and maybe you're in a role where, okay, I just got to get better at it. And so really understanding where on that continuum should you be, and then pick a couple things. Don't try to boil the ocean on digital mindset. Pick the things that you think are going to be the greatest impact to you, to your career, to whatever business you're working within. And then just focus there first. Start with one thing and get comfortable with that thing. And then you might diversify from there. But really try to, you know, move the needle first, get comfortable, and then keep experimenting.
And as leaders... Oh, go ahead, Debbie.
I was just going to say, and also, like, there's this thing called budgets. You can only do so much in a given year. So really that prioritization, you know, and I'm a firm believer, like, you don't just put a bunch of resources out there and let whoever takes it is great. And, you know, it's all a pull strategy. You know, we need to think about who needs it the most. How would we prioritize it? How do we assign it, you know, track it? How do we make sure we measure the effectiveness that it's driving the skill change and the business impact that we want? Those are all really important elements of the strategy as we kind of come up with what are our priorities for 2022 and beyond.
And when I think about both of those items, so Cindy, you mentioned something around kind of understanding where you are in the continuum. And I feel like as leaders, it's our jobs as well to help our teams understand where we expect to be. So maybe Debbie, could you talk a little bit about some of the work our teams are doing to help map competencies and really understand kind of where their team should be at? And then that, I think, lends to a lot of the work that Cindy's team's doing on how do we build those training curriculums.
Sure. I mean, whether it relates to our digital mindset capabilities or our functional capabilities, we've spent a lot of time the beginning of this calendar year last year to really identify by function and overall digital mindset, what are the expectations really behaviorally, what will it look like? How does different levels of proficiencies look like? Where would we say we are now? Where do we want to be based on roles? What gaps do we see? And then that really leads to what are your priorities from a learning strategy standpoint? Once again, you have to kind of prioritize what are you going to do next year and how do you build on that year over year in the continual pursuit of mastery?
Oh, I like that. The continual pursuit of mastery.
I have a feeling I'll be doing that forever.
Especially in this space. So I'm going to take another question from our audience. So Ganesh has asked, how do you measure adoption to ensure individuals and teams are moving forward and don't roll back or get stuck? So Cindy, maybe you want to take that one?
Yeah, there's certainly places that we're going to have very focused curriculum, as Debbie mentioned, where, you know, we're looking at effectiveness measures, and not just effectiveness measures of, you know, I attended that, so check the box, it's over. I mean, we should see business metrics change, right? Debbie showed the four pillars that we have as a strategy for digital. Each of those has, you know, business metrics attached to those, you know, initiatives that are attached to those. So we should see success in those. based upon people continuing to work on whether it's their functional capability that's needed for that digital strategy or the digital mindset. We have, pulse surveys that we'll be leveraging here at Eaton as we continue to progress and understand where we are. We have those continuums that I mentioned that we're currently doing at an individual basis. We're debating whether we'll continue to do that, at a much larger scale. And we're working on a digital mindset curriculum. So we'll have more to share, for our teams around what that's going to look like and how that badging will work. But it's not just, take the training. No learning is good until you start building the muscle. And the outcomes of that muscle are going to be in the results. It's going to be, is it more efficient? Even in my own team, we're working on our data analytics skills. We're working on, how do we automate and simplify processes? Well, mm-hmm. over time, I should be able to go out to my, my teams and say, hey, is life easier? Are we feeling like we're more productive? Are we spending less energy and time on, tasks that hopefully we've automated? And sometimes we find that we're doing great, and sometimes we find that we've taken processes back because there were a couple blips along the way. And, I think it's like for a leader, I think it's also a constant conversation of if you are a leader in any business today, it's not just what your business strategy is. It's what's the strategy of the team that I'm driving? Where do I need those skills? And then making sure that if we say, okay, data analytics skills are important, you should start to see, the folks in your teams, showing that capability and showing that competency. And so we'll be doing formal ways to do that here at Eaton. But I think the informal can be just as powerful, if not even more so, when it comes to helping support people to continue to build the skills, because some of them are harder muscles than others. And it's going to take actually doing it to really build it.
And some of the measures they have a longer tail to show up too. So, of course we'd like to have immediate impact in our sales as soon as we hold some sales training or some product management training. So like really kind of thinking about what are some of the immediate KPIs we want to see in the near term and then longer term that what the revenue will flow. So how do we get better at measuring that? I'll be honest, we're on a journey there too, making sure that we continue to really raise the bar on how we're measuring impact. And making sure that those things that we do that, as we are spending our precious resources, time and money on those, that they're really doing what we need them to do, if not adjust. Pivot.
And another question, right? Another question we got that I think dovetails off of this. Robin asked, how can companies balance the benefits of embracing digital tools and also I think this investment in onboarding to those tools? Like, how do you balance that idea of, hey, like, there's dollars that are associated with that, but it's something we need. So maybe Debbie, you could talk a little bit about that too.
Well, I'm going to toss that one to Cindy.
Cindy's our
Cindy.
Well, Debbie already said earlier that budgets didn't go away. So I thought in the digital world that, P&L went away. I think Robin brings up a very serious challenge that I don't care what industry, what business you're in. This is the debate. At our company, we're having that debate every single day in probably every single room that exists today. And, there's a standard piece around the ROI. There's the standard piece around where is a digital tool going to enable you more so than where not? What's the return on that investment? But the biggest thing that I've learned from some of the things I've seen working is experimenting helps. And this is where, that whole agile mindset of digital mindset kind of comes into play. And I've seen more and more, even with some of the technologies around, and we're working, to ensure that our IT teams and our engineering teams and our digital teams are sort of connected on where we're bringing technologies in, but also enabling us, like, let's try it out. We're doing that even with some of our curriculum right now. We're in the middle of pilots, hey, let's get this team through this pilot. And you just see so much more of that happening because it helps you to inform, all right, if I scale this up, it's going to be a major investment. Can I try it out? Can I get a sense of how effective it is quickly? And then look at how I scale it over time. But I think we won't solve that here today. I think that is the greatest challenge that every business is facing right now. And I think the ones that are going to win are the ones that are being really smart around making sure they've got a strategy. They know what an end game looks like because you can't just invest in every cool. I mean, I don't know about you guys, but my phone rings off the hook. My LinkedIn goes off every day. I could spend 24 hours on the call, on the phone with vendors every day around digital technologies, just in learning alone. And so, you know, how we get smart about which ones are going to actually get me to my end game, and what's my end game look like? Do I even know what that should be? And I do know that in the learning space. And so those vendors that might be listening on today's call, I'm calling you back if I feel like you're fitting in to where I'm headed, you know, and I'm exploring ways to experiment. And I think that's one of the ways that you can kind of get through some of those challenges on the investment side, because it is a real challenge.
And it does start at the top too, right? We at Eaton, we have a focused, not only strategy, but leadership kind of direction, right? And impetus behind what we think this means for our organization. And I think that that's so important, right? Digital transformation isn't something that you can do kind of piecemeal, right? It's not like, oh, everyone just kind of go off and do something and you'll all of a sudden transform your organization, right? It really does need to be structured. It needs to be driven by a strategy, but also led from the top of the organization.
Absolutely. And I think when you do that, and I think we're in a good spot with that right now, and like any great strategy, right? We had places that went faster, and you know, we've kind of morphed into now we are in this collective sort of Eaton strategy. And there's places where once you have that vision, then you can experiment within that vision. And so there might be a business or a tech we're going to try, but people are connected and they're aware and they're able to figure out, okay, well, if this works out, how would I play that in? And I think that goes to that kind of hyper collaborative piece on digital mindset that becomes so critically important, because you can't have 75 different ways to do the same thing either.
Not very efficient. And that does lend itself to another question from our audience. So Mustafa is asking how we internally and with customers and partners are communicating in this kind of hybrid workplace. So we're doing a virtual event now, kind of leveraging our digital muscle to do this LinkedIn Live. But there's also a lot of opportunity, especially during the pandemic, right, where we've learned a lot about how to communicate in a hybrid workplace and what that means for our organization. Debbie, do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Is there a question?
So how are we communicating in this hybrid workplace? Like, how are we leveraging technology with internally, but also with customers?
Yeah. I mean, I don't know if Eaton is that different from all the other companies out there, right? I mean, you know, depending on where you sit in the world, whether or not you can go to the office or not varies, right? So if you're in, you know, it's all a continuum on if you can be in the office or not. If you're in an area of the world where you can't, then it's all about leveraging things like Microsoft Teams on a regular basis. As well as, you know, everything doesn't have to be in a meeting. How can you use digital tools to collect information, be more efficient? You use IMs more than emails is one of my personal favorites. You know, so just how do you make sure that you're as most effective as you can be, whether you're in the office or whether you're virtual? How do you manage that? What is the phrase that fatigue that comes with being on too many Zoom meetings or team meetings? Is it called Zoom fatigue? I don't know. Like, how do you just manage that? You know, if you're designing a meeting or designing training, how do you just understand that reality and make sure you build it so it's going to be most effective are some things that come to my mind. But Cindy, what would you add?
Yeah, I think all of those are fantastic. And I think, you know, another place, it's funny, you know, COVID is such a, it comes with its blessings and its challenges, right? And one of the blessings I think was it took us digitally forward by years in the space of, you know, whatever it's been 18 months. And so it's funny how things that were impossible are now the norm. And, you know, one of the things for me that just jumps out is, you know, we used to do customer visits and testing with customers and, you know, all of that on a very large timeline. You had to get all the players involved and, you know, even just small technology that's helping to enable that is the augmented reality. You know, just getting the goggle, you can do the test, the customer's on the screen. Just so, you know, how fast and efficient and really helpful it's been. And we had that technology all along. You know, we just weren't embracing it maybe as much as we are now. But I think it does come with its challenges. Debbie mentioned the Zoom fatigue. I'm sure all of you on the call that have teams. I have a team that's quite remote, quite global. You know, there are things that I am starting to see, you know, the challenges of not physically coming together and the relationship building side. And so I think, you know, regardless of how easy it might be to be remote, figuring out how do you continue to drive the relationship building, because you can't get to fast collaboration. You can't get to quick hits and being able to pivot if people don't trust one another, if they don't know one another, if they're not comfortable. And I think that becomes the challenge in the hybrid workforce, that anybody who's leading a team of people today, or even if you're in a team of people. And so when you see that, we just need more connection, how do you create that? Mm-hmm. Because I think it is something that we just got to keep focused on. I do think the hybrid workforce will continue. Mm-hmm. I think it'll get even, more interesting as COVID hopefully, continues to get more in control and more people get back to the office. But then even how do you have the challenge? And that's where augmented reality is kind of a cool way. We did a meeting. It was a HR leadership team meeting. And, obviously, maybe our friends from APAC couldn't get all the way over, or from Europe, just couldn't travel because of country restrictions and everything else. And, we actually used augmented reality in a staff meeting, and we experimented, we tried it out, and we couldn't believe how well it worked. And so just little things that you can do to make sure that people feel included, I think, is really critically important, especially given some of the restrictions travel wise.
Yeah, maybe it links back to that onboarding discussion we were having earlier too, like, thinking about how do you onboard differently, or, what roles really do need, if they can, what roles really do need some face-to-face connections. I know I was having a conversation with a colleague yesterday, and they were saying that their child had two internships, one that was fully remote and one that was in person, and how they were wildly different. And she got so much more out of the in-person internship than the virtual one. So just thinking about, how does that relate to when we're onboarding maybe early talent? Do we want more of that to be in person if it can be, because it's such a critical phase for people coming out of university?
I think that's a great point, that kind of different place you are in your career, but also the different kinds of roles mm-hmm. you have.
Yeah.
But it really does feel like for all of us that those relationships mm-hmm. and maintaining those relationships and building trust is not only important to just enabling a digital mindset, but continuing to grow in your career and be successful and, be collaborative.
Yeah.
If you don't have that, it's really hard to do.
Yeah. I mean, another part of our journey has been really to create a feedback culture. So if you are going to be virtual, you might not have that trust if you're not giving each other the feedback that needs to be done. So we've really been focusing on asking for feedback and continuous feedback, which I think really enables that digital mindset as well.
So we have another question from Pratik, who's asking if digitalization helps us to leverage the skills that we're seeing from people who are entering the workforce, maybe people who learned to code in middle school and high school, right? We've got new generations of employees entering the workforce who have a lot of these skills, and how is that affecting our talent strategy?
Hmm. I mean, I would say every single year, the people coming out of university come with different skills or other technical development programs. So it raises the bar on what we can expect. And then it probably also influences the skills that others who are already here see coming in and really helps us elevate our game. So, I'm not super close to exactly how that would impact our talent strategy, but I would have to imagine, based on all of the great development opportunities available to early talent, that it absolutely has to be raising the bar.
And I do think companies are using so many cool digital technologies, ourselves included, to try to ensure that we've got visibility to that. Because I think that was the challenge without digital tools, is somebody might have a really cool technology, or, hey, I've been a coder since I was 10 years old, whatever the case may be. Unless that was on your resume, maybe didn't have the visibility to that. And so there's a lot of digital tools out there. Eaton is using, other companies are using, to make sure we're capturing that. And then we're looking at ways, and I know other companies are too, where we can actually market to our internal candidates just as much as we market to our external candidates based upon the skills that people are self-identifying. So that I think it is a new age and a new era for skills. There's a lot of research out there around, moving from jobs to skill, even skill-based, compensation is also a topic out there. I think we're still early in the maturity of some of that work and how that's going to look in the future, but it's a very exciting time. And so if you've got skills and they're not named somewhere on LinkedIn or in some sort of database, make sure you're naming them, make sure you're calling them out, because it's going to become a way in which I think those identifying talent will certainly be easier, hopefully, as we move forward.
And one of the cool things that I want to bring up that we do at Eaton that I think is a great way to start gathering some of that is something we call the Stretch Assignment Marketplace, right? Where our business leaders can go in and they can put projects in a digital tool, right? And people from around the organization can kind of nominate themselves to participate on a project that's kind of outside of their day-to-day job. But it's a great way to get an understanding of some of the skills you have in the organization that maybe you weren't aware of. Someone who's really knowledgeable in, you know, voice of the customer research, or someone who's really knowledgeable in coding or data science or analytics that you might not have known because of where they sit in the organization. Their opportunity to participate in projects like that is not only great for them to be able to flex those muscles, but it's great for the organization to be able to leverage those skills that you might not have known about before.
Yeah. Even build another skill, right? That's something we're trying to get our heads around now is, you know, maybe there's a way that we can further, you know, increase our digital strategy and build digital skills through projects that we can put out there that people can start. You know, we kind of talked earlier, some of these things are building muscles. How do you, you know, have some projects that help people to build muscles, maybe where skills they don't have too. So lots of companies getting super creative that. I love our stretch assignment marketplace. It's a great tool to do that.
Yeah, and I think another similar tool that maybe is a little bit shorter is we're starting to experiment with hackathons. Our IT function just launched a hackathon where they're gathering ideas on digital transformation. So I don't think that's as long as a SAM project, but it's another way for people to provide input. Yeah. Crowdsource ideas.
That's great. I think both of those are great kind of new ways that we're trying to gather that information. You know, when we talked a little bit about the pandemic, right, and how we thought that that really pushed us to, at Eaton at least, to transform faster than we may have been transforming. Charles asked, how do we make the next kind of COVID level jump in digital without being forced into it? Maybe you each want to touch on some things, some thoughts that you might have about how kind of you can help the organization move faster.
Yeah, I've been in senior leader meetings, over a year ago where that exact conversation was happening. You know, what did we learn during COVID and how can we reinforce those types of changes in our organization? I don't think it's like an easy answer. I don't think there's a silver bullet, but I think we just have to keep asking ourselves those questions and keep pushing ourselves to think differently about, you know, just how can we just really push ourselves to move faster and do things dramatically differently and not just do push for incremental improvement. Mm-hmm. Be more comfortable taking bigger risks.
Cindy, is there anything you'd want to add to that?
Yeah, you know, it's funny. It makes me think of an article I was reading last night. You know, like any good LinkedIn Live, you got to do a little prep reading. And it was talking a little bit about, you know, leaders that struggle in the digital space. And one of the things that, you know, it mentioned was just that comfort with the status quo or being afraid to change. And I think if you're leading a group of people or you're working in a group of people, I think the one thing we kind of assume that change isn't going to happen as fast as it often does. And, you know, COVID was forced because we didn't think that would ever be a possibility. And I think hopefully it's taught us that anything's a possibility and that anything is sort of up for grabs. And so I think, you know, to me, that's exciting. Like I would love to, like, what does learning even look like 10 years from now? We don't even know that. And so to me, it's exciting to say, okay, we've had this, and there's a number of programs that we have even in Eaton around learning that maybe we've had for 10 years. And then I kind of, you know, I peel the envelope back on that one and I realize, oh gosh, there's like no usage. Okay, so why aren't we, you know, cutting that and focusing energy on where people are needing things? And so I think, you know, really being in touch with what's happening, what's the art of the possible, you know, if, you know, are you leading, are you lagging as a digital company? Follow the leaders then. If you feel like your organization is not going fast enough, pay attention to who's going faster and what are they doing. I participate in the conference board. And, you know, there's tons of ways to get engaged, to get thoughts and perspectives around how are people doing things differently. And that could be the new COVID world differently or, you know, completely blowing up a construct or thinking about it totally differently. But I think if regardless of what role you have, whether you're a leader, individual contributor, doesn't matter. If you're not thinking about that today, and thinking about, could this happen differently? What happens if this is no longer a way to make this happen? Then I think you're kind of missing the boat. And so the beauty I think that's come for our company is people are thinking like that now. It's unusual for me to meet a leader of a business or a function that isn't thinking about, oh my gosh, anything's possible. But you worry you'll lose that. And I think that would be the shame, is if we get back to normal and we get back and it's like, we don't lose that kind of fire in our belly of how could this change? Yeah. Or how would I even want to make a change? And that's a big piece of digital mindset, is having that continuous sort of fire in your belly and that curiosity for how could we rethink this, or should it be rethought? And I think one of the dangers is getting complacent and being, you know, kind of adverse to the possibility of that.
And maybe just not expecting the change to come from above also, right? Like to think, what can I do?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it's that ownership piece, right? Feeling personal ownership around how you grow the skills to enable that digital mindset so that, you know, even if you're not the leader of the organization, right? Can you bring ideas to the team because you're thinking about what's coming next or what can make your job more efficient or what can make you more mm-hmm. effective?
Mm-hmm.
And so when we kind of go towards that discussion and we start talking about what are the ways we can help understand where we fall on the scale, right? What are the skills we need to learn? Where are we today? Right. So for each individual person, how they can start thinking about, you know, what skills do they need to grow? What proficiency do they have today? Cindy, can you talk a little bit about ways we have to look at that?
Yeah, I think, you know, I talked earlier about the continuum that we've built for our internal talent. You know, if you're out there and you're not part of Eaton today, by the way, Debbie mentioned we have jobs open, so that's awesome. You know, there are actually lots of free assessment tools out there. So you can actually type in free digital mindset assessment. And there are tools that are available that you could get a gauge on sort of where you are today. And, you know, I like to think of it in sort of two buckets. One is my technical dexterity. How comfortable am I with digital tools and tech? And what ones matter to me in the space that I'm in? And then the other piece of it being that whole mindset piece of it. And there's really great tools out there that exist, whether your company creates them or you just Google it, that can give you a sense of where you are and where you want to focus. And again, I think it's really focusing in on, you know, what's most important to you. And so I think, you know, I'm going to use my own world as an example. I mean, I run a COE, which is Center of Excellence here at Eaton. And, you know, I think for a long time, COEs, you know, we created what we thought was good. And maybe we did a little external benchmarking, and then we, you know, we leashed that onto the organization and said, you know, congratulations, you're getting this benefit of this great thing I created. We have learned, my team, we've been experimenting in the space of design thinking a ton over the last, even before COVID, you know, probably the last 2.5 years or so. And we have seen it dramatically change how we think about learning at Eaton and how we think about our offerings. We've done a whole overhaul of our UX based upon the crowdsource perspective of our customer, which is internal. And so, you know, that's just one example of my world of how I'm thinking about, you know, what digital skills do I need? Well, one of the ones we need is more of the mindset piece around that customer. How do I get that customer input? How do I approach it from, you know, a journey map or an empathy map of what's important to my customer? But everybody's going to be different depending on where they're at. So first getting a sense of that continuum, and then where in that continuum does it matter for the work that you do, and prioritizing from there.
So another question from our audience, and this one is specifically for Cindy around the learning aspect. So we think about how we manage knowledge retention and capture, because, you know, we've got a larger part of our workforce that's potentially eyeing retirement. Right? New folks coming into the organization who need to learn the business, there might be a gap there. How we use tools to create standard work, but also kind of gather that knowledge to be able to share it. Can you talk a little bit about some of the things that we're doing at Eaton?
Yeah. So Austin's bringing in my digital AI dream is coming to the forefront of this question. So, you know, like any company, we're on that journey. We have a vision and we have a destination that we've started to kind of chart forth. You know, we have created actually, we have a talent hub in the organization, which is a digital tool for talent to identify their own skills, their own certifications. Each one of us has a profile in there that they can fill out. And I would recommend, if you're listening to this today and you're internal and you haven't done that, do it, please. We're working to ultimately link Talent Hub with our learning. And so as all of our learning is housed within Eaton University, the ability to have visibility to who's getting trained on what, who has what, and then you kind of added in that difficult challenge of, you know, who might leave the organization, whether it's through retirement or other things. There's so many predictive analytics these days that, you know, we've got the exciting thing for me is we have the talent to analyze the data now in-house. We've got an amazing data science team. We've got an amazing analytics team. Our challenge is making sure people are leveraging the tools that are available to us and then us maturing and connecting those tools as fast as we possibly can. So that's kind of a little bit of our vision and where we're headed, you know, at Eaton.
Great. You know, I'm going to take, I think we've got time for maybe one more question. So we're going to take a question from Andrea, and she's asking how large organizations like Eaton can really standardize on tools and things like data analysis output to help drive efficiency in the organization. And Cindy, you just started kind of touching on this in your team, but what are some of the things that larger organizations can do to help that process?
Yeah, I think I'll kind of start and then Debbie can kind of add in here. But I think, you know, our digital officer as well as our chief technology officer are constantly talking about CI. And so I think, you know, one of the one of the things I think is important to think about when you're going digital, say you're digitizing a process, you don't want to digitize a bad process. And so I think large organizations have to first determine what processes are important. You can't boil the ocean. So what's really important that we streamline, we get efficient. I talked about the two that I just mentioned, right? And then making sure before we even get to what's the digital solution, how do we ensure that the process works well? Because if you try to digitize a bad process, it's going to actually throw you backward. So I think that CI piece is important. I think prioritizing where standardization means the most and matters the most versus where variability can exist. I think systems is a big place where standardization is going to matter. And it might not be every single process that goes into a system, but there will be certain things that have to be common in order to get the value, you know, of a large organization like ours. To be able to see something, for me to be able to see learning across the entire organization, there are certain processes that have to run really well. There are certain things that need to be digitized in the same way. Now, there's other areas where, you know, we can be differentiated in a region, and maybe it makes sense that we're differentiated in a region because of a market issue or a market need, but we're making those decisions thoughtfully. And so I think, you know, making sure that you've got really good processes, that you're prioritizing what needs to be standard and differentiating where it matters. And then I think really being thoughtful, don't be random about it. It's that random act of digital thing. I love that mention, but it's very, very true. And I think especially in a large organization, you have to be even more thoughtful about that interplay together.
I think that that applies to the digital tools as well as your learning approach. You know, there are certain things we're going to want to have the same language, the same learning approach for data analytics or Agile, for example, throughout the company. And then the other idea that came to my mind while Cindy was talking, everything doesn't have to be created in the center too. So if there's a new idea that comes from anywhere in the business, how can we learn from that and leverage it more broadly if we can or should?
Share best practices, right? Mm-hmm. How can we share that more within the organization? Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Well, ladies, our time is coming to an end. Thank you both so much for an engaging and insightful conversation. And I want to thank our attendees also for so many great questions in the chat and sharing your time with us today. We really appreciate you taking the time. And certainly if there are other questions, you know, keep adding them into the chat. We can see if we can answer as many as possible. And certainly if you are interested in learning more about career opportunities at Eaton, as we've mentioned, there are some jobs open. So please visit us at eaton.com/careers. Have a great rest of the day and week.
Thanks, Ari.
Thank you.